Ram and friends, last time when I was talking on the Leninist conjuncture, I had put forward the argument that in the post-Second World War period, there was a restructuring that capitalism underwent, but there was no corresponding restructuring in socialist societies. And I think even the presumption that the sheer march of history, the sheer progress of the revolutionary movement would bring onto the socialist camp newer and newer countries, and that itself would get rid of some of the aberrations that were contingently forced on the existing socialist systems. That presumption was also belied by the fact that there was a change in conjuncture and the revolutionary tide came to an ebb. But the restructuring that capitalism went through was one which was not, which itself was forced upon capitalism by the circumstances that prevailed. It was forced in the sense that there was a very serious perceived communist threat. Even though in the Yalta and Potsdam agreements, and there was an understanding that the Soviet Union would not encroach upon the Western European countries in order to induce a movement towards communism, in lieu of the fact that the capitalist powers were willing to accommodate the fact that in Eastern Europe many of the countries joined the socialist camp because of the march of the Red Army. Despite that understanding, there was nonetheless a perceived communist threat, which arose for a number of reasons, one of which was the enormous prestige that the Soviet Union had acquired in the course of the Second World War, the enormous prestige that the communists had acquired because of their stellar role in the anti-fascist struggle in France and so on, for instance. Thousands of communists had actually laid down their lives as part of the partisan struggle, the Chinese Revolution, and so on. So there was a perceived communist threat, notwithstanding the Yalta and Potsdam agreements. Now, that being the case, capitalism was more or less forced to restructure itself, and also this was forced by the fact that there was a rise in the social and political weight of the working class in the post-war period. So one way that capitalism decided to meet the communist threat was by unleashing the Cold War, and the other by having to undergo a certain process of restructuring, whose major components were decolonization, the introduction of Keynesian demand management policies that actually kept capitalist economies pretty close to full employment, and that in turn unleashed a period that has been referred to as the golden age of capitalism, and of course the introduction of democratic institutions into the capitalist system. I mentioned that even though there was a gap of at least three quarters of a century between the consolidation of the bourgeois state and the introduction of the democratic institutions in the advanced capitalist countries, nonetheless, this introduction of democratic institutions opened up ways of struggle before the people, before the working class, which had not been available earlier. The fact that I would like to now look at this restructuring in the context of the way I perceive the system. Capitalism, in my view, is a spontaneous system. Philosopher friends object to the use of the word spontaneity, but I mean it in a very specific context, and I'm indebted to the Polish economist Oskar Lange for this particular term. It's a spontaneous system in the sense that it is driven by its own immanent tendencies. Now, of course, you have human agents whose actions, whose decisions in the overall sense determine in the aggregate where the system is moving. But these human agents themselves because they are subject to the force of competition, more or less are coerced into acting in particular ways, so that you could, without really doing violence to reality, see the system as propelling itself forward through the intermediation of human beings who more or less act in particular ways because of competition and become instruments in the process of this self-propulsion. Karl Marx had actually referred to the capitalist as capital personified. In other words, the capitalist, the supposed hero of the whole system, was not someone who was acting under his or her own volition. The capitalist was acting in specific ways because he or she was subject to competition, and therefore among the capitalists there was a Darwinian struggle in which some would perish, and because of that, certain kinds of behavior, like for instance accumulation, introduction of technological progress, all of it was more or less forced on the capitalist. The incessant development of the productive forces was more or less forced on the capitalist. Now, in this spontaneous system, the role of the state is generally to carry forward these immanent tendencies, among which, for instance, one can think in terms of this process of centralization of capital, which Marx had highlighted. That is an immanent tendency of the system. The process of capitalism encroaching upon surrounding pre-capitalist environment, that again is something which is really a part of the process of the dynamics of the system. The fact, for instance, that every object becomes a commodity over time, again which Marx had highlighted, is another of the immanent tendencies of the system. Now, all these are tendencies which the system necessarily in its process of self-propulsion through the intermediation of human agents who are more or less acting as instruments of this self-propulsion, these are the tendencies that it exhibits and manifests itself. The role of the state is actually to aid these tendencies. By the way, in my next lecture, I'd like to say that a very basic distinction between Marxism and liberalism arises because of this. So, insofar as the state actually plays this particular role, there may, however, be certain exceptional circumstances in which the balance of class forces, the balance of class strengths is such that the state does something different. Now, when it does something different, what happens? When it does something different, then you can think of it, I mean, like for instance happened in the post-Second World War period, you can think of it as a state displacement. By state, I don't mean capitalist state. I mean a position displacement. There's a system which is being driven by its immanent tendencies. The actions of the state displace it from that trajectory to something else. But after this displacement, as long as the system continues to be driven by the same tendencies, then it would actually continue to be again a self-propelling entity. If the state acts in a way which actually thwart these tendencies, in that case the system becomes dysfunctional. When it becomes dysfunctional, then there are two possibilities. One is that in a recursive manner, then the intervention of the state would have to be more and more kind of, deeper and deeper, more and more comprehensive, or alternatively, and this more and more comprehensive would eventually lead to a transcendence of the system, or alternatively, the state begins to withdraw from intervening, and when it begins to withdraw, then once more you have a reassertion of the same immanent tendencies which had existed earlier. Now, the post-Second World War situation can in fact be interpreted in this particular way. Surely the golden age of capitalism that actually brought capitalist countries very close to full employment. For instance, in the early to mid-60s, Britain had an unemployment rate that was about 2% of the total workforce. These are all official figures. The United States in the Kennedy years had an unemployment rate that was about 4%. 4% of the total workforce. It is argued, of course, that the actual unemployment was higher than the official figures, but nonetheless, these official figures were so low that capitalism had never in peacetime really hit such low unemployment rates over such a long period of time. Now, if you have such low unemployment rates being sustained, then that is clearly something which really goes against the immanent logic of the system. Why does it do so? Because capitalism can never do without a reserve army of labor, which has at least three important roles to play. Two of these are generally well recognized, but I'd like to add a third. One of which everybody knows, is that the reserve army of labor is essentially for restraining the real wages of the workers, because of which when labor productivity rises, the real wages don't rise, or even if they do rise, the fact of the surplus value being extracted from the workers does not disappear. Many of you who are students of economics would know that the economist Joseph Schumpeter had actually said, but look, this Marxian theory of surplus value is all wrong, because of course you'd have competition which gives rise to a situation where wages rise relative to productivity and profits disappear, because there is a lot of competition for the workers. But the presumption behind that is that the economy actually functions at full employment, but it doesn't. Long before the competition for workers has taken the economy anywhere near full employment, you would actually have the accumulation process slowing down. There are inner ways in which capitalism reproduces the reserve army of labor and recreates it. As a result, the system simply cannot function without a reserve army of labor for the very process of surplus value extraction, for the very process of exploitation to continue. A second very important role that the reserve army of labor plays is the following: that work motivation, work discipline, which under a feudal system is enforced through coercion, through the monseigneur's whip, is in a capitalist system, where monseigneur's whips have been done away with, is enforced through the reserve army of labor. If you do not act as you are told to act, you are a worker, then out you go, you are thrown out. And of course, being thrown out would have no bite if there did not exist an army of unemployed whose ranks you join. If you had full employment, in that case, there would be no work discipline under capitalism, which, by the way, is one of the reasons why virtually the whole of economic theory that proceeds on the assumption that the capitalist economy achieves full employment is fundamentally wrong. If it achieved full employment, there would not be any work discipline or work motivation within the logic of that system. But the third reason why a reserve army of labor is very important for capitalism, which is less discussed, is the fact that wage bargain is in money terms. If you have a reserve army of labor that has actually got dwindled, in that case there will be a demand for high money wages, and if there's a demand for high money wages, and of course capitalists jack up prices as money wages rise, then you'd have a system of inflation, which money wages and prices chasing one another in a spiral, and that would destabilize the value of money in a system that's fundamentally based on monetary transactions. So it is extremely essential in a money-using system like capitalism that the value of money must remain relatively stable, and is very important for that you must have a stability of money wages, for which the reserve army of labor is very important. Many of you would know that these days there's much talk about inflation targeting. Why is it that capitalist countries are so worried about inflation targeting? Because inflation is something which really demolishes the system. There is a very interesting, I may have mentioned it in one of the earlier lectures, but there's a very interesting remark that Keynes makes in Economic Consequences of the Peace, which goes as follows: that Lenin is said to have remarked somewhere that the best way to destroy the capitalist system is to debauch its currency, and Lenin is right. So that is what Keynes says. So anyway, so because of that, a reserve army of labor is extremely important even for maintaining the stability of the money values of the system. And by the way, even though capitalism has come a long way, the very process of this enormous financial superstructure which has been built on the system requires all the more that the value of money should remain relatively stable, because all these financial assets are money denominated assets. Now this is something which therefore, in one sense, the maintenance of high levels of employment over such a long period of time is something that really went against the basic immanent logic of the capitalist system that requires substantial levels of the, or appropriate levels of the reserve army of labor. And this therefore eventually manifested itself in the late 1960s in an inflationary upsurge that that characterized the whole of the capitalist world. At that inflationary upsurge, suppose it is the case that capitalist states had gone on towards further intervention in the sense that, you know, okay, wages and incomes policies, they tried wages and incomes policies everywhere. That is, as it were, raising the intervention of the state a little beyond simply providing a large amount of demand to generate close to full employment. But of course, once you have wages and incomes policies, if you freeze the share of the capitalists, then they may not invest at all. They may not even accept the wages and incomes policies. There may be violation of it, in which case it would become very important for the state itself to step in as an investor, for the state to undertake public investment. In other words, the point I'm trying to make is that in order to sustain your intervention, you have to actually keep raising the level of the intervention. And that's what the bourgeois states were not in a position to do, which is why once the inflation had gone on, then you had a withdrawal, a reversal of the intervention, and that came with Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan and so on. I mean, the whole emergence of an alternative position that got currency under capitalism, an alternative to the position that social democracy had taken, is something which was basically because the intervention of the state in the capitalist system against the imminent tendencies of capital did not, as it were, recursively keep raising their levels. There was a second problem which also arose in post-war capitalism, and that's a problem which Marx had highlighted, and that's the centralization of capital, the coming together of vast masses of capital in concentrated blocks. Now, in order to understand why this happened, let us just think of the entire capitalist world as one entity, including Japan and so on. Now, basically, what is happening is that during the period of the golden age of capitalism, you had high levels of investment, high levels of growth, and therefore high levels of savings inside this capitalist world. And the private savings were not only high enough to finance the investment, but they also had to be high enough to finance the US government's borrowing, because the US government was borrowing in order to maintain a string of military bases all over the world. The US government's level of borrowing kept going up, and of course it went up dramatically during the Vietnam War, as the Vietnam War hotted up around the mid-70s. As a result, huge amounts of private savings were generated inside this universe of this capitalist universe. Now, these private savings were in fact handed over to those who required these savings through the intermediation of the banks. But there was one very specific thing. Under the Bretton Woods system, the dollar was supposed to be as good as gold, and the US borrowing, therefore, took the form of a costless borrowing. They just printed dollars. European banks held on to these dollars, and when they held on to these dollars, the US government had to pay no interest rate because, you know, it was supposed to be as good as gold. As a result, a lot of the European banks were very keen that, look, we are holding all these dollars, but we must earn some income on it. One way of earning this income would have been to invest it all over the world. But under the Bretton Woods system, every country had capital controls. They were controlled on capital inflows and outflows. As a result, pressure mounted in order to get rid of those capital controls. Initially, there was a movement of funds, you know, I mean, hot money flows, which was in violation of the Bretton Woods controls. But later on, in fact, Europe first, Latin America and Africa later, India in 1991, we began dismantling capital controls. The Bretton Woods system of controls completely collapsed. And that was the beginning of the process of globalization of finance, globalization of capital, and in particular, globalization of finance capital. Now, there is a lot of misconceptions about globalization, and I think while those misconceptions may not be common in this room, it's worth actually getting rid of some of them. There's one view that basically globalization, which is associated with the pursuit of neoliberal policies, entails a retreat of the state. That the state, which earlier was intervening, no longer intervenes, which is a completely false conception. What happens is a change in the nature of the intervention of the state. Just imagine, we are in a world where there are nation states. Okay, governments are really representing nation states. But on the other hand, capital is globalized. That's the essence of the process of globalization. Capital, in particular finance capital, is globalized. Now, if you have globalized finance capital and you have nation states, as I once mentioned earlier, then of course the nation state willy-nilly has to do what globalized finance would want it to do, because otherwise it'll just leave the country. Keynes had been aware of this, as I mentioned last time, and in his Yale Review article he had said, finance must be national. In other words, globalization finance prevents the autonomy of the nation state to pursue whatever policy it wishes to do, because if finance is global and the nation state remains a nation state, then it will have willy-nilly to do exactly what finance demands. Now, therefore, what actually happens is not that the state retreats. The state retreats from some range of activities in order to intervene in the economy in a different way. Its retreat takes the form that while earlier the state appeared to stand above society and appeared to be intervening in the interests of all kinds of classes as a kind of, you know, umpire, as a kind of neutral entity standing above society, increasingly what happens in the period of globalization is that the state acts in the interests of globalized finance, in the interests of what one calls international finance capital. Now, the fact that the state acts in the interest of international finance capital implies the pursuit of a whole range of policies which more or less are pretty common everywhere. You know, I mean, we know what these policies are, the neoliberal policies and so on, which I need not repeat. But one very important implication of this should be actually kept in mind. I mentioned last time that one of the reasons why the period of inter-imperialist rivalry, which had characterized capitalism in the interwar years, was superseded by, that the inter-imperialist rivalries got muted in the post-war period, is because there was one power which was far more powerful than anything else. Some people have referred to as a period of US super-imperialism. US was by far the leading power. It really did not have any other powers to challenge its kind of hegemony. And consequently, in some sense, the muting of inter-imperialist rivalries was a reflection of the power relations within the capitalist world. But with the emergence of international finance capital, the muting of inter-imperialist rivalries actually becomes a characteristic of the system. Why? When Lenin was talking about the fact that, you know, that each inter-imperialist rivalry and each of these powers or within each of these major capitalist countries, you have a financial oligarchy that presides over the sphere of finance and industry, and that is interested in carving out an economic territory for itself at the expense of a rival financial oligarchy, that the British finance capital struggling against the French finance capital, German finance capital struggling against the British and French finance capitals. The whole idea is really of finance capitals which were nation-based, nation-state aided, and within each country represented a coalescence of industry, finance, and of course the state personnel. But now what happens is that if you have a division of the world into rival economic territories, then that goes against the fundamental interests of globalized finance. Globalized finance would like to go all over the globe. Therefore, any arbitrary barriers which are imposed against such movement is something that they dislike. So obviously, a hallmark of globalization is not that the world be partitioned into different spheres of influence, but that all such partitions must disappear. And that's exactly why now the muting of inter-imperialist rivalries actually takes on, really becomes based on the material reality of the emergence of international finance capital. Many people have actually referred to this new situation as, okay, there was a debate, as many of you would know, a debate meaning there was a disagreement between Lenin and Kautsky, you know, that in when Lenin had written his Imperialism, there was a big attack on Karl Kautsky's views, and I'll just very briefly mention it. And many people have seen the current conjuncture of globalization as one which represents a triumph of Karl Kautsky over the Leninist position. Why do they say that? You see, Lenin had said that you have different kinds of finance capitals, as I said, German, British, and so on, and they would be always trying to partition and repartition the world in accordance with their relative powers, relative strengths, and so on. Karl Kautsky, who was, as you know, a very, very distinguished, well-known Marxist theorist of that period, had put forward the view that can we not imagine a situation where there is there's an agreement among the different finance capitals, that they're not forever locked in bitter rivalry, but there's an agreement among the different finance capitals. So you have the joint exploitation of the world by internationally united finance capitals. In which case, of course, the fact that wars must always occur is something that need not happen, because you can actually have a joint exploitation, which is a peaceful exploitation, because these finance capitals would no longer be at loggerheads with one another. Against that, Lenin had argued that suppose we visualize, and Kautsky had called it a state of ultra-imperialism. Now, Lenin had said that suppose we visualize such a situation, suppose there is an agreement. Capitalism is forever associated with uneven development. The uneven development would mean that the relative strengths on the basis of which an initial partition had been done of the world would be changing. And as they change, there would be an effort to redraw the partition, to repartition the world, and that itself is going to generate conflicts. So conflict is something which is embedded in the very fact of uneven development that capitalism necessarily engenders. Now, many people say that, okay, I mean, now that inter-imperialist rivalries are not there, Kautskyan position has been vindicated as opposed to the Leninist position. I'd like to see it differently, namely that both Kautsky and Lenin were really talking about nation-based finance capitals either being at loggerheads with one another or combining with one another. But we have really gone beyond that very idea of nation-based finance capital. We now have international finance capital, not internationally united finance capitals belonging to different nations, but a genuine international finance capital to which the financiers, financial oligarchy of different countries are closely integrated. And that being the case, is not a question of Lenin versus Kautsky, but in fact the world has moved beyond both Lenin and Kautsky. This is the way I'd like to see. Now, this process of globalization is one which has at least three very important characteristics which I'd like to underscore. The first characteristic, which many people have talked about, is of course what they call financialization. Financialization, which is analogous to industrialization, which had occurred earlier. There's an enormous weight of the financial sector. Of course, financialization proceeds much more, has proceeded much more in the advanced countries compared to the developing countries, but nonetheless, it's a global phenomenon. The second feature, which I think is quite interesting, is that now you have, quite apart from financialization, or, you know, if you like, that there is, I'd like to draw a distinction between capital as finance and capital in production. When you set up a factory, there's capital in production. But if you have finance that's moving around, employing itself in stock markets here or there or something, there's capital which is mobile, which is capital as finance. While there's an enormous growth in financialization and therefore in the weight of capital as finance, as far as capital in production is concerned, you have a diffusion of activities from the metropolitan core to a number of countries like China, India, East Asia in particular, which is really quite a novel phenomenon. Why do I say it's a novel phenomenon? Because if you look at the history of capitalism, then typically what happened? In the colonial period, there was deindustrialization. You had, let's say, British textiles getting rid of our weavers in India, China, etc., which actually produced unemployment, huge reserve armies of labor, huge labor reserves, and very low subsistence wages. But the remarkable thing is that British manufacturing capital, let us say, or capital in production, could have come to India and China, used this low wage labor in order to use the same technology that they were using back home to produce for the world market. Then, of course, their profits would have been higher. But that did not happen. If it had happened, in that case, the dichotomy between the underdeveloped and the developed countries would have, to a significant extent, disappeared. The fact that it did not happen, the fact that there was a segmentation of the world economy, meant that labor from the south was not freely allowed to move to the north. Capital from the north did not move to the south except to mines, plantations, and, you know, managing agencies and so on, which were really part of the same international division of labor, but they did not shift manufacturing activities from north to south. So you had a segmented world, and as productivity increased in the advanced countries, wages also increased, and there was a gap therefore between the subsistence wages in the third world and the wages the workers had in the first world. This appears now, at any rate, to have changed. Now, what you do find now is a shift of activities from the advanced countries to countries like China, East Asia, and shift of service activities to an economy like India, not that much of manufacturing, in order to take advantage of the low wages, in order to produce for the global market, not just the local market, but produce for the global market. Now, when that happens, then labor in the advanced countries begins to compete against labor in the underdeveloped countries. That means basically you have a situation where wages there can't rise. As a matter of fact, I probably mentioned that Joseph Stiglitz has estimated that the real wages of a male American worker in 2011 was no higher than in 1968 and perhaps marginally lower. So what you find is that, taking the world as a whole, obviously, there is this diffusion of activities taking place, and its implications we shall discuss in a moment. And the third feature, to my mind, the third very important feature of globalization, which in a sense defines it for at least societies like ours, is that it completely gets rid of whatever state support and so on existed as far as petty production, peasant agriculture are concerned. I said there's a change in the nature of the state under globalization. This change in the nature of the state takes the form whereby in the post-war dirigist regimes that came up after decolonization, the state played the role of actually defending, sustaining, promoting petty production and peasant agriculture, but now the state increasingly refrains from doing so because state policies are now much more geared towards keeping up what is called the confidence of the investors, which basically means appeasing the bunch of speculators and financiers who move their money around the world because of the globalization of finance capital. This withdrawal of state support from petty production and peasant agriculture is one which basically implies that we have an agrarian crisis, huge amounts of peasant suicides because two ways. Firstly, agriculture ceases to have the kind of profitability it had earlier, which, if you like, in flow terms implies the squeeze on the incomes of the agricultural sector and of petty producers. When I was in Kerala, I used to work in the planning board, we once made an estimate, and you found that suppose the fisherman sector, you assume that every fisherman was getting what was the minimum wage in the state, which used to be paid in Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Schemes. Suppose you imputed that wage to every fisherman, then you found that the sector as a whole was in deficit. In other words, you found that the fishermen got a return per labor day that was lower than the minimum wage that they could have earned on an MGNREGS project. It's a very interesting and moot point on which many people have written. Why, in such a case, does a fisherman continue to be a fisherman? Why don't they go and work in NREGS? I think that's a very deep issue, which, you know, Christopher Hill once wrote an article that because of the fact that they don't want to give up their freedom for a mess of pottage, you know, that basically the conversion of petty producers to the role of workers is something which is such a severe and painful transition for many of them, because of the fact that being a worker means you are under coercion, that they would take substantial cuts in their living in order to continue as petty producers, though of course their children and so on might actually join the ranks of the proletariat. But the point is that therefore you find that the petty production and peasant agriculture sector is in deep crisis, and what is more, also in stock terms, that means in terms of asset transfers, there is, as you know, a substantial amount of conflict that is currently evident because land of the peasants are being taken over for supposed industrial projects, which basically means in class terms a process of acquisition of land of the petty producers by the capitalists. Now, this is something which Marx had referred to, and of course the land is not taken over gratis, but nonetheless is taken over at prices which are generally throwaway prices, and this is something which Marx had referred to as a process of primitive accumulation of capital. Primitive accumulation in flow terms, in terms of a squeeze on incomes, primitive accumulation in stock terms, in terms of taking over property gratis. Now these are the various, to my mind, very significant social implications of the process of globalization. But I want to now move on a little to the question of how globalization impinged on the socialist countries. Now, I think basically I mentioned earlier that under the socialist countries, under socialism as it existed, because of the fact that a lot of aberrations had occurred, which at the time were considered contingent, and which it was believed that the ongoing revolutionary process, march of history, would actually correct these aberrations, these aberrations continued, and that produced a new kind of alienation as far as the people were concerned. Not what is, not what you find in capitalism, but nonetheless something which is no less real. It was real. Now, one of the ways in which many of the governments, which were all party dictatorships, tried to acquire credibility in Soviet Union and Eastern Europe is by increasing the consumption levels of the workers by borrowing from abroad. In other words, this was a period in which lots of loans were available, globalization of finance, finance is available. As a matter of fact, there was a loan pushing. They would push loans to all kinds of countries. And of course, since loans were available, many of the socialist countries actually got indebted. I remember, I think, with Professor Chandrasekhar, we had gone to GDR and we asked the economists there, but you know, I mean, isn't it rather disturbing you're borrowing so much from the international market? They said, but you know, our per capita loans are still very small. But the point is that one way that the socialist countries got trapped into this process of globalization is by getting indebted, which appeared at one point to be a very smart move, that you're actually raising consumption levels by borrowing. But when it comes to paying back the loans, you have problems arising. There's anticipation of exchange rate depreciation. You may not have enough foreign exchange. And if there is even anticipation of exchange rate depreciations, you find that even many of the public sector enterprises, which were exporting enterprises, didn't bring back their foreign exchange earnings. Something, by the way, that also happened in India. Now, if an export earner does not bring back the foreign exchange earnings or delays bringing back the foreign exchange earnings, then that is exactly analogous to a capital flight. Because that basically means that money which should have flowed in is not flowing in. And that put further pressure, and that is when the economies really started getting into a tailspin. And of course, at that point, as you know, many of the apparatchiks then simply grabbed hold of state property through a massive process of primitive accumulation of capital and set themselves up as capitalists. Now, it is quite amazing that you had a socialist country, but almost immediately as socialism was collapsing, you had the emergence of these billionaires in Russia, one of whom actually bought up the Chelsea Football Club in London. So it's quite remarkable that once the economy got into a tailspin, then all these, then all these problems arose. And as I mentioned last time, not only is it the case that the leadership of the Communist Party set themselves up as presidents in all the republics to which the Soviet Union got fragmented, you know, Leonid Kravchuk, Edward Shevardnadze, Islam Karimov, Nursultan Nazarbayev, and so on. Boris Yeltsin. But what is more, you also had apparatchiks taking over state property. The other way that socialism actually affected or globalization of finance, the availability of funds, the movement of capital, global movement of capital was used by the socialist countries was in the case of China. In the case of China, while there was a resistance to the inflow of finance, they were quite careful, but at the same time, they actually encouraged the inflow of capital in production in order to set up enterprises for meeting exports. And of course, China became an enormous success story as far as exports are concerned. Very high rates of growth, everybody knows about it. There is a question which arises, and you know, it's not, okay, this is a very contentious issue, that in China, as a result of all this, have we now got to a situation where the labor reserves have disappeared? There is no doubt that wages have increased, but the point is that we must not forget that much of the increase which has occurred in the real wages in China of the workers has been decreed by the state. In other words, the state has administered a real wage increase. If there is a certain, and even this increase is really much more in the coastal areas, even if there is an element of tightness in the labor market, that is something that does not extend to China as a whole. Certainly in the interior of China, and also if you look at the age group of 50 to 60, you find that, you know, there are some sample surveys and so on, there is a fair amount of unemployment in the age group of people who are in the workforce, but in the age group of 50 to 60. So it's not as if labor reserves have disappeared, but of course the Chinese government has increased real wages. But there is a necessary limit to the extent to which the government can do this, because the whole economy has survived upon being a successful exporter. Now suppose it is the case that the Chinese wages rise because the state has decreed a rise in Chinese wages, then fairly soon you'd find that the location of export activities will move to other places where labor reserves exist and where real wages are still low. So the Chinese real wages in this kind of a regime cannot be too much out of line with the real wages elsewhere. And therefore this necessarily puts a constraint upon the degree to which the Chinese real wages can rise. It's an interesting proposition that in China, in fact there was an article in the Financial Times on October 2nd, in China now there is a very significant growth of a neo-Maoist opposition, a neo-Maoist movement. The October 2nd Financial Times said, I mean I'm not taking that at its face value, that if there are elections today between the Communist Party and the neo-Maoist opposition, the neo-Maoists are likely to win. But okay, whatever you may say, but certainly while earlier the opposition to the ruling party came from the so-called pro-democracy movement, now the opposition comes to a very significant extent from the much greater extent from the neo-Maoists, who are, and there's an enormous nostalgia for the, you know, egalitarian period which characterized the Maoist era. So the point is that it seems to me that even in China one has to take the success of the Chinese growth story with a certain amount of reservation at any rate. How has globalization affected the people of the world generally? I mean, how can we look at the impact of the process of globalization on the different segments of the world's population? We have now a certain study, Branko Milanovic, who's a person who works on income distribution, just written a book. But broadly one can say that everywhere in the world, the top 1%, the proverbial top 1% that the Occupy movement was targeting, has done remarkably well. In fact, in India, wealth inequalities have increased so dramatically that roughly the top 1% now controls half the wealth of the country. There's a real increase. So inequality at that level has increased indubitably quite dramatically. As far as the workers in the advanced capitalist countries are concerned, their conditions certainly are really pretty bad. I gave you Stiglitz's figure, and many of the resistance currently, of course, in the guise of right-wing resistance, because they are led by a lot of, I mean, Donald Trump or UKIP or Marine Le Pen and so on. Now that is something which is a reflection of the fact that the working class in particular has really done very badly. I believe that it's important for the progressive left elements in all these countries to recognize this and to take up the resistance of the working class instead of shunning it on the grounds that this resistance currently is linked with the right. But that's something which I'll try and talk about next time. But when it comes to workers in the third world, or working people in the third world, by which I mean petty producers, workers, peasants and so on, one should have thought that there should be a rise in their wages. One should have thought that the shifting of these activities should actually have made them better off. As a matter of fact, what you do find, however, is that despite all these shift in activities, you still have very significant labor reserves. I said in the case of China, it's a matter of debate, but in the case of other countries, other third world countries, there's absolutely no doubt that there are very significant labor reserves which are not used up, because of which their wages continue to remain at a subsistence level as far as the workers are concerned, and what is more, unemployment takes the form of labor rationing, in work rationing in the form of casual work, casual labor, intermittent labor, disguised unemployment, petty entrepreneurs. In fact, it's remarkable that a lot of the petty entrepreneurs are supposed to be Dalits. Now, this is something which is tom-tom as a great achievement, that look at the way that Dalits have become entrepreneurs. As a matter of fact, that's really a form of disguised unemployment. An analogy that I'd like to give you, I think maybe I'm not sure if I gave it last time, that, you know, that during the Great Depression of the 1930s, there were a lot of shoeshine boys, you know, people who didn't have jobs. They just kind of started sitting behind by the road in order to shine shoes. So you could say there's an enormous boom that is taking place in the shoeshine industry, that employment in shoeshining has really shot up. But as a matter of fact, that is really a symptomatic of disguised unemployment. On the whole, and of course, the dispossession of the peasantry, the squeeze on the peasants, the squeeze on the incomes of peasants and petty proprietors that I talked about, petty producers, is something all of which implies that the working people in the third world countries, despite the shift of a set of activities, are not really any better off. Maybe they are also worse off. And certainly, when you look at nutrition data, hunger and so on, you find this to be the case. What has happened, however, is that there is a certain improvement in the condition of a segment of the middle class. This is true of China, this is true of India as well. Now, it's a moot point whether the middle class has expanded in numbers, but insofar as almost 50% of India's workforce is still engaged in agriculture, it is unlikely that the middle class has expanded so much in terms of numbers, but it has actually become much more visible because its relative incomes have really increased dramatically. As a matter of fact, I once made a very simple calculation between the salary of a professor, where when I joined JNU as an associate professor, our salary was 700 rupees basic. You look at the salary of a new associate professor today, and the factor by which it has been multiplied is way, way above the factor by which the procurement price of wheat has gone up, for instance. Therefore, if you simply compare peasants and professors, then you find that professors are doing very well compared to peasants. And professors, by the way, are not the best paid, not at all. So you do find that actually there is a remarkable rise in terms of the relative incomes of the working class, of the middle class. Now, this therefore would suggest that in the days to come, we may see, I mean, how things are going to pan out is difficult to say, because the current crisis of capitalism, about which I'll talk next time, is something which is going to impinge on the middle class as well. In which case, it is possible that there would be a certain middle class joining of the resistance of the working people that's taking place all over the world. But on the other hand, if that does not happen, then you may well find a situation where there is a conflict of interest between the middle classes on the one side and, of course, the working population on the other side. And then that becomes a very important test for the left, that it must be on the side of the working people. For instance, if you look at the Brexit vote, London, which is where British finance capital is concentrated, and where you have a significant middle class associated with the financialization of the economy, voted against Brexit. But on the other hand, all the working class areas that you find in Britain voted strongly in favor of Brexit. So you find that this kind of a difference is beginning to manifest itself. How it pans out is something that remains to be seen. Before I end, I'd like to draw your attention to one point. One of the things about the collapse of socialism that took place, which actually for a very long time had left someone like me personally very sad, is the fact that, you know, that it left so little residue. Okay, you had the English bourgeois revolution of 1640, but on the other hand, even when you have the restoration of the monarchy in 1688, between 1640 and 1688, there has been a substantial achievement of the revolution, which continues to remain. Okay, the restoration was not a restoration of the monarchy the way it was in 1640. You look at the French Revolution, okay, it is true that Thermidor happened, then Napoleon happened, then all kinds of things happened. But at the same time, the basic achievement of the revolution in terms of, you know, whatever, distribution of land, smashing of feudalism, there was a residue that remained throughout all this. One of the sad things I used to feel about the collapse of socialism is that, you know, you cannot detect any such residue. It's almost as if socialism just collapsed and all the gains of it disappeared. But on the other hand, when you actually think about it carefully, what it means is something which is extremely interesting. What it means is that, you know, that between capitalism and socialism, there is no possibility of a little bit of gain beyond socialism. In other words, a collapse of socialism necessarily means a victory of capitalism. When I was a student, we used to have interminable discussions about whether the Soviet Union is state capitalist, whether the Soviet Union is this or that, that is not a socialist country, but it's all kinds of other things. We thought, and Burnham and Carter wrote in this book called Managerial Revolution, that really you can actually have a situation where managers run the economy. Galbraith talked about technostructure. So many people used all that to say that even when you don't have private property, you actually can have a system which is a managerial capitalist system or a state capitalist system and so on, that is possible to have some intermediate state between capitalism and socialism. The fact that there is no residue, the fact that the Soviet Union's collapse or that of Eastern Europe actually meant a complete submersion of these countries within the capitalist orbit suggests that there is no such intermediate step that is possible. And it suggests, therefore, that really between capitalism and socialism, it is, as Eugene Portier had written in his famous song, The International, la lutte finale is the last struggle. And if you lose the last struggle, you're back into capitalism. And that's the basic difference between bourgeois revolution, all previous revolutions, and the socialist revolution. The socialist revolution is the last struggle. Thank you.